This episode of Digital Photography Cafe is brought to you by Focus Pyramid, the autofocus lens calibration tool for your camera, and by Daisy Grip, for a child's smile for a photographer's camera.
Welcome to the Digital Photography Cafe. I'm Trevor Current, your digital marketing guy.
And I'm Joseph Christina, your professional photographer.
So grab a latte, pull up a chair, and join us as we chat about the art and business of photography.
So hey everybody, welcome back to the show. Last week we talked about watermarking your images and some great local networking opportunities. If you haven't listened to last week's show, I encourage you to do so. You can find it on iTunes, or listen in your car through Stitcher Radio, or simply head over to the website, digitalphotographycafe.com, and listen online.
So Joe, we're back. Episode 54. How's it going?
Very good. Episode 54. Awesome.
Yes.
We are here. We're doing it. And we're actually doing it in a timely manner this week.
Yes. Yes. Yeah. We kind of were a little late with last week's because we wanted to announce our big iPad Daisy Grip giveaway winner.
Yeah.
So now we're actually recording in our normal time frame. So this will be out. And our normal Monday time slot.
That's right. That's right. Exciting.
Yeah.
So what do we got going? Cool. I heard we got a really nice email from somebody, didn't we?
Yeah, we did. We did. We got an email from a guy. His name is Mike from NovoPhotography.com. And it turns out he's a brand new listener. He actually stumbled across us through a link on Twitter or something.
Well, so. Welcome, Mike. Welcome to the show.
Yeah, I guess all that pimping out the show on Twitter works, right?
That's right. That is right. And we do a little pimping out of the show on Twitter.
Yeah, you know, sometimes you just have
you
to,
have
right?
to do it.
Yeah,
absolutely.
So, so he emailed in with a comment about our watermarking conversation from last week, which was really good. So we wanted to talk about it on the show. And, you know, so he was kind of adding to what we talked about. And if you didn't listen to the conversation, definitely go back and check out, you know, episode 53. You can hear a whole big discussion about watermarking your images. But, you know, what he wanted to add was for wedding photographers or anybody, you know, portrait photographers, anybody that's producing images, let's say, of people. You know, if you're posting them online to be seen by the clients and family and friends, pretty much everybody has access to it. You know, they're not in a private gallery or anything like that. He suggests actually using a kind of a larger watermark across the middle of the image. And the reason being is, you know, when you photograph people, people are a lot more willing to have lower res, lower quality images that they can print themselves of their family and friends, as opposed to paying for them. So if, you know, his thought being that if you don't watermark it or you use a little watermark in the bottom, they'll take it and just, you know, do a screen grab or, you know, a right click and bring it on their computer, print it out, and you'll never get any additional print sales.
Yeah,
so, you know, which I think actually, you know, makes a lot of sense, you know?
Yeah, true. You know what? I don't hate that idea.
Yeah,
I kind of like it. Yeah, no, it's very true. I'm just joking, but yeah, it's you know, watermarking, and I know we talked about it last week, but watermarking is kind of like, it's kind of odd. You know, you do it, you don't do it, you almost have to. Some people don't, but I understand what he's saying, and I agree wholeheartedly. Watermarking should be associated with the job. And it shouldn't be one size fits all. And when I say that, it's, you know, I'll give you a perfect example. Let's say you're doing like a high school, you know, sock hop, you know, some type of dance or something, you know, you're doing this dance and, you know, you're going to be taking the entire senior class dancing. Well, when you put those online, you know, the senior, they're not going to have money to buy this stuff. You know, most of them won't. There'll be a couple of purchases here and there, but most of the time they're not. So in that case, what you want to do is you want to have a larger watermark to use those images as advertising, because you know the seniors are going to put them on Facebook. They're going to pin them. They're going to put them through Twitter. They're going to put them everywhere. So what you need to do is you really, you know, and kind of, you know, solidify that is there's multiple ways of doing it, and there should be multiple sizes. And like I said, it's not one size fits all.
No,
and
I agree.
I think that, you know, I was looking at this, and I kind of want to, I'll share something really quick on what I do. I use Lightroom. I'm a Lightroom user for a long time. You can do that, and you could do this in Aperture. You can do this in Photoshop, whatever you want. I like Lightroom because it allows me to go and set up presets for watermarks. So what that means is when I go and export images, I can say, okay, go ahead and use my 4x6 watermark, or go ahead and use my 8x10, or go ahead and use my Facebook watermarking, or go ahead and use my Google Plus watermarking. And what that means is I can have different styles of watermarking, different sizes, different shapes, different colors, different locations, sure. Everything in accordance to where it's going to go, where it's going to be, where's the final location. So in this case, let's say it's that senior, you know, portrait session or that senior dance. Well, that one might be the, let's just say the aggressive watermark, preset.
The big obnoxious watermark. That's right.
The nasty one.
No, exactly. I agree definitely with that. As photographers, part of our additional income is through product sales and print sales. Right. And if you're basically giving, free access to the images online to clients or to people who may potentially buy additional right. products from you, you're kind of losing business. And there's definitely nothing wrong with protecting your business investments. If it's a means throwing that watermark on there so it's a little bit more of a deterrent for them to, right click and print it themselves. You know what? And there's going to be some people that will be fine with there being a watermark across the middle of the image. They'll
print it that way too, which is crazy. And they'll print it at 72 PPI and they'll print like a little, one way or another, if they want it, they're going to take it. They're going to get it.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And that goes all back to Photoshop too. I mean, if they really want it bad enough and they want to go in and retouch that watermark out, they're going to do it. Not much you can do about it, but realistically, they're not going to be your customer anyway. They're never going to buy from you. And there's always going to be people like that out there. So I think it kind of just is one of those things. Yeah. So anyway, great
if
comment.
If you want to go in there and clone stamp for 6 hours, just have at it.
That's right.
Or you want to pay $25 for an 8x10 or clone stamp for 8 hours. I mean, for me, for a 72 PPI image, pay the $20 and just, but
get a nice print.
That's, a photographer's point of view. But anyways, I found something on the web that I wanted to share with you and everybody, which, a couple of bullet points that I thought was very interesting, kind of going into the multimedia aspect. Now check this out. Listen to this. Over 4 billion videos are watched on YouTube every day.
Four billion.
That's with the big B, right? Now check this out. Every 20 seconds, there's over 20 hours of videos uploaded to YouTube. Every 20 seconds. Jeez. Can you imagine that? 20 seconds, there's 20 hours. You can imagine. Wow. I can't even imagine the file system they got going on over there.
And the bandwidth usage too,
right? The bandwidth and the size, the terabytes, it must be unbelievable. Ugh. Now check this out. Online video budgets will increase 47% in 2012. Mm-hmm. Now that's an interesting point right there. 47, that's almost 50% increase in video budgets, right?
Right.
Check this out. 90% of all internet traffic, right, for 2012, 90% mm-hmm. is estimated it's going to be coming through video. That's from Cisco. Those are the people that have the routers, all over the place, and the NOCs and the network operation centers.
Yep.
They know. 90% is from video, right? Listen to this. Bottom line. Website visitors will stay on your page longer if you have video on it, right? That's a fact. Yep. We know that. That's a definite fact. One last thing, really interesting. Online shoppers are more likely to buy a product, doesn't matter what the product is, if there's a video associated with the product somehow, somewhere, someplace. It doesn't matter if it's on YouTube, if it's on, wherever it is. If there's a video regarding a product, they're more likely to buy it. So what does this all mean? To me, it goes back into the multimedia. If you haven't been playing with video, as most of you guys out there are photographers, right? We know that. If you haven't been playing with video yet, you really need to start. You need to start because The bottom line is video is where things are moving into. That's one of the reasons why, you know, you and I have started doing the show, but on a video side. Why? Because, you know, we have X number of listeners as of right now. So, right?
Yeah.
Once we are in video format, we're going to have X number more now listeners slash viewers of the show. It will, you know, it allows us to not only be audio out there, but we're going to have video too. Allows us to expand our name, everything, you know, the whole show would be bigger. So video is something that's so important. And I think it's one of those things that we're going to have like probably an entire show just to talk about. But I kind of wanted to use that as like a teaser, because if you're not doing video, start looking into it, because we're going to start talking about it more into some, in some shows coming up.
Sure, absolutely. I mean, the opportunities moving forward for photographers who are moving into video are really, really good. I mean, if you're if you're a commercial photographer, let's say, and you're already doing, you know, a lot of still shoots, you know, if all of a sudden now you can start doing video, because these, you know, these marketing people are learning that, you know, hey, we need video to help sell our products. Exactly. Well, if you're shooting stills of their products already, you know, maybe you start offering some video services. Say, hey, we can incorporate video and some, you know, voiceover and this and that. And now you've just increased your sales and the services that you offer. So, yeah, I agree 100%. I mean, I think video is definitely the way to go. And it is the future.
Yeah, it's going to definitely warrant a few shows for sure. But, you know, just like you said about, you know, okay, so what do you do with it? Well, one of the points that we just kind of alluded to, that shoppers buy product based on videos.
Yep.
So just if you just simply think of yourself as a product, what that means is the person out there, let's say it's the bride or the art director or whoever's picking the photographer out there, will most likely buy you slash hire you if you have a video out there. Maybe you have a simple bio where it's your video and you talk about who you are, what you do, and how great you are at doing it, and why they need to hire you and not the next guy. Or maybe even better, it's a video of someone that you shot recently, or maybe let's say it's a bride and a groom, and they talk to the camera about how great you were at doing your job. That's even better.
Sure. So, I mean, yeah, that's what we talked about a lot in the past too, about the behind the scenes videos and how powerful they really are.
Huge.
And looking at these numbers, that just confirms it, right?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Yeah.
Well, I tell you what, Trev, before we go any further, let's go ahead and take a quick break to hear from our sponsor.
Awesome. Have you ever tried to photograph a child who was on the move and wouldn't settle down? A child who just wouldn't give your camera the time of day, no matter what tricks you tried? If so, we have some great news for you. Introducing the Daisy Grip, your go-to tool for capturing a child's smile.
Just think of the Daisy Grip as your third hand. Just place it into your camera's hot shoe, insert the child's favorite toy or puppet, and let the smiles begin. Imagine the storytelling magic that you'll have at your disposal with a ferocious lion or a friendly monster sitting on top of your camera. For the ultimate attention getter, place your smartphone into the Daisy Grip and play the child's favorite cartoon.
With the addition of a Daisy Grip bracket, you can free up your hot shoe for a flash or a wireless transmitter.
Let Daisy Grip put the space above your lens to work for you. Make this indispensable tool your new best friend. Head over to daisygrip.com/DPC to get the listener discount.
The Daisy Grip. For a child's smile, for a photographer's camera.
So, all right, guys, something very interesting that we kind of found in the on the web as of this week, and it had to do with Twitter. Twitter is doing something really interesting, and what they're doing is they're putting together a weekly digest that can end up in your inbox.
Yeah. Yeah, it's pretty kinda cool. It's taking like the best of the tweets or the best stories for the week. And kind of creating this email digest
And the stories, though, what's really important is the stories are all of the people that you're following.
Yeah.
So it's actually taking, you know, back like when we would do, you know, we would log into, let's say, a bulletin board or a PBS or whatever it is. And we're in there chatting with people and we are interacting in different forms inside, let's say, in a whole bunch of different topics. What it can do is aggregate everything that we have discussed and sent you, let's say, a weekly or a daily quote unquote digest of everything that you were talking about. And this was always great for years and years and years. It was a great way to keep on top of what you were talking about on all these different message forms.
Sure.
So we got Twitter that's doing something very similar. These are all of your friends, all the people that you're following. And now everything that's important, that they're saying, that is trending, that other people are retweeting somehow. I'm guessing, you know, they have an algorithm on here. Twitter's probably doing something to figure out what's important, right?
Yeah, well, that's it exactly. They're looking at the tweets and the stories, you know, the articles, the links, you know, that people are sharing to the blog posts and stuff that are getting the retweets or that are getting the views and just straight tweets. Those articles, those types of news stories are what's going to move to the top, the ones that Twitter deems as popular. So it, you know, obviously, you know,
right.
My followers are photographers. So if Chase Jarvis, for example, puts out a fantastic article, which he usually does, talking about something, if that gets a lot of views and a lot of tweets and everything, then that article from Chase may actually show up in my email box as far as this, you know, is part of this Twitter giant.
As a trending topic from your friends that are from the people you're following into this digest type form. And I like this, and I'm guessing, I haven't seen it yet, but I'm guessing you'll be able to see, just like, you know, old school with these digests, you'd have the name, like the topic, and then you'd have what it is, and it's probably going to be clickable. And if you click it, it probably takes you back to the story. So you can kind of get back immersed into kind of where you left off or what they're talking about or in kind of, you know, watch to see what's transpired. So
yeah,
I like
that's exactly
really
right.
Cool.
I mean, when the email comes in, there'll be a link for a story, let's say, that will take you to the site so you can read the story. Now, the other thing that is included are popular tweets, let's say. So if there's a tweet out there that, let's say, is a quote, people love quotes. I don't know. A lot of people really love quotes, whether they be quotes from Ansel Adams or, you know, Confucius, you know, people love quotes and they retweet them and retweet them again and over and over. And that is another type of thing that may show up in these articles. So, all right. So how is this relevant to you? How is this important to you? So if you're a photographer and you are running a blog, a companion to your portfolio website, which you really should be, if you have a great article that you just wrote and you share it on Twitter, and you get a lot of your following retweeting it and sharing it with their communities, and you've got people clicking through on the links and reading it, because now every time you put a link out on Twitter, Twitter's shortening it with their t.co shortener.
Exactly.
So Twitter is keeping track now of all these links that are being clicked through. So they're able to create this aggregate of clicks and be able to determine the popularity of an article. If that article happens to be yours, then what could happen is your article can actually appear in this email that is sent to, you know, who knows, hundreds of thousands of people's email inboxes.
Yeah.
You know, which is huge. I mean, that's like, that's email marketing for you right there.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, that is huge. I mean, and if you're, you know, if you've got some great witty, piffy things to say and you're tweeting these little 140 character words of wisdom, and those get shared a lot, it's a great way for you to get exposure.
Right.
So from a content producer, from somebody creating content, this is a great opportunity.
Yeah. I mean, anytime that you can get into someone's inbox, you're golden. I mean, that's fantastic, right? But now to actually get there repeatedly, because you're actually sharing stuff that, you know, is deemed as high quality content. I think it's really smart what they're doing, because it's going to, you know, all the, you know, what you had for breakfast and what you're going to have for lunch, and, you know, I'm sitting here doing nothing, twiddling my toes and fingers or whatever, that kind of stuff is just not going to end up, you know, in people's inbox.
No,
it's going to, you know, it's going to behoove you to come up with 140 characters of high quality content if you want to use it as a marketing tool, which is what we all want to do. Somehow we want to get people back to you as the product, so that you can sell yourself. So right. Yeah, I think that's great. I mean, let's say if you have, I mean, technically, like let's say we have right now, I have, I don't know, let's say 10,000 photographers that follow me. Well, if I had, you know, I said something pithy, you know, something that was insightful, and a lot of people retweeted it, now all of a sudden I have a, you know, possibility of 10,000 people seeing that. But instead of just, you know, going by at the speed of light, you know, in their Twitter feed, it'll actually be sitting in their inbox waiting to actually read it. I mean, that's gold. That is gold.
Well, that really is the power of email marketing. And that kind of, you know, brings us into our next topic. We've talked about email marketing a couple times on past shows,
right.
More of an overview, kind of just touching on the idea that you need to be involved with email marketing.
Absolutely.
So what we kind of wanted to do was flesh it out a little bit more, talk more about exactly what to do and kind of why you should do it. So,
right.
You know, like, I mean, the first thing that I would say is if you're not involved with email marketing right now, you need to be. The proof is there. I mean, email marketing has been successful for years and years and years.
Absolutely.
Yes, things are changing now with spam and people are deleting and stuff like that. But it's still one of the most powerful digital marketing channels that you can take to get your word out. So if you're not already doing it, you know, you need to do it as part of your Twitter, Facebook, you know, your Google Plus, and, you know, Pinterest now.
Yeah, Pinterest
marketing,
now, absolutely.
You know.
Yeah, and the whole idea too is, you know, many people will be like, okay, so now how do I start? You know, I don't want to start spamming people. Start with the people that you know. Start with the people that you've already worked with. If you don't have a database of everyone that you've worked with since day one, well, you know, your workflow is broken.
Yeah,
you need to fix.
Yeah,
you need to fix
shame
that.
On you on that one.
Yeah, you need to start out there. You know, start, you know, aggregating all of the email name and email addresses of all the people that you've worked with over the past X number of years, and that's where you would start. And it's very easy then to communicate with them and say, hey, you know, we worked together in the past. You don't have to say how long. I have this new thing going on. I have a great, you know, I have a gallery showing that's going to be happening. We would love for you to attend. It's free of charge and we'll give you, you know, wine and cheese, you know.
Yeah.
Why not come by, you know, kind of to reintroduce yourself to past clients. Because many times, you know, we get so just, you know, worked up with doing the client, giving them the work, and then going on to the next one because we're so packed and so inundated with work and with new clients continuously. We sometimes, you know, fail at keeping that connection. Facebook is one of the great ways to keep connected, obviously, with past clients. But I think what you're saying with email marketing is probably number one. If there's any way to get, like we said, into their inbox and do it nicely, let's say, yeah, that's definitely a way to go.
Well, that's absolutely right. I mean, you never want to spam people. You don't want to put together an email marketing campaign that is nothing but spam, just simply self-promotional. Hey, this, we've got this sale and you know, buy now, click here, and flashy things and all that stuff, because that doesn't do anybody any good. I mean, somebody's going to look at that, and even if they know you, they're just going to delete it. I got to tell you, years ago, I purchased a Toyota truck. And of course, you know, now everything that you buy, they want your email address, you know,
right.
So they can, you know, send you marketing materials. Okay, I get it. I understand that. And there are good, legitimate reasons. Service reminders. Hey, you know, it's about time for your oil change, blah, blah, blah. So I have no problem with that. I think that's a great idea.
I get those all the time from Toyota, actually.
Yeah. I mean, I've since gotten rid of that Toyota. It was a lease. 3 years is up. It's gone. And now I got a big ass Dodge.
Yeah.
I don't.
And you're probably still getting those things from Toyota. Hey,
I'm still
get your oil change.
Yes. Years later, I'm still getting these emails from Toyota. It's trying to sell me with their flashy blinky things and stuff like that on a new Toyota. Well, I don't want a new Toyota right now. I've got a vehicle, you know, and I get it. I understand it. You know, they're doing it for a reason. They're trying to stay in contact, just like what we're saying now with past customers. Because if the time comes that, you know, my wife needs a new vehicle or I'm getting rid of my big Ram, you know, then, you know, I may be considering a Toyota again. So that's right on. It's how you do it. It's all about how you do it. You've got to make a good marketing message, a good message. It doesn't have to be a sales message, but it's got to be a good communication, something that people will actually care about. And really, you know, what I really recommend doing is using MailChimp. MailChimp is probably one of the most cost-effective and most powerful email marketing systems on the web today.
Yeah, I agree.
Just a free account alone. I mean, this is amazing. I mean, I just don't know how they do it, but a free account alone, you can have 2,000 contacts and you can send out 12,000 emails per month.
That is a lot of email.
Yeah, I mean, that's
especially as a photographer.
2,000 contacts a month. I mean, that's a lot.
As a photographer, I mean, normally we don't have, you know, how many clients do you have per year? It's not, even if you had, you know, one per week, let's say, that's 52. So, you know, 12,000, you know, 12,000 emails or 2,000 contacts. I think we can actually do it through MailChimp and not have to worry about even paying
and for not have
it.
To pay anything. Absolutely. Yeah.
It's and a their great
tools,
service.
I mean, their tools are very powerful. Their system is very robust and it gives you the ability to really design your emails to look good, not just using some cheesy template. I mean, they have templates that they've developed and you can start with those. You can modify their existing templates. You can create your own from scratch.
Right.
It really is very flexible. It's a great system, you know, and they're not a sponsor. I mean, they don't pay us to say this. I mean, it's just from personal experience. We use them for DPC. We use them for current photographer. You know, I use them for a couple of my other clients. I like their service and they're always reliable and they're very conscientious about the spam regulations and they will crack down on you. Like you wouldn't believe if see that you're spamming. I mean, you're done. They'll freeze your account and you're done. And I respect that because they want to keep their name reputable with all the ISPs and they don't want to get, you know, blacklisted for
absolutely
for being spammers.
Because if they did, then when you use them and let's say you sent to 100 of your clients, there might be only, you know, 40 clients that would get your message because the other 60, you know, is blacklisted and is thrown in, you know, it's dev nulled. It's thrown into a black hole and the message never gets there. So yeah, it behooves them obviously to be conscientious, but they've been like that ever since day one.
Right.
It's a really, really great system. I love the whole way that they have the templates set up. You can customize them. You can do whatever you want with them. And, you know, maybe you go in there instead of doing a customized template, maybe you just use one of their templates because they have a lot of good ones. And then obviously, instead of trying to send some kind of sales pitch, you just send, you know, a, hey, how you doing? You know, first email to everybody to kind of break the ice.
Break
and say,
the ice,
hey,
absolutely.
I'm still here. You remember I shot you back in 1999, you know, whatever.
Right.
I don't know how long you've been in business, but you know, whatever it is, you know, all of a sudden I figured out that I need to keep in contact with you. I'm sorry. Shame on me. It's been 10 years, but hey, I'm still here and I'm taking pictures, you know, or maybe now we're also doing video or whatever it is. So yeah, that initial kind of breaking the ice, I think it's a good way that you can just kind of get in there and do it with one of their own, you know, one of their, generic templates and because they're great.
Yeah, they really are. That's right. I mean, just a FYI, hey, I'm here, we're still alive type of thing. That is definitely a great icebreaker. And then your follow-up emails can be along the lines of whatever. Hey, you got new services that we're offering just to let you know, or hey, we're getting close to the holidays. Have you been thinking about your holiday portraits? We're here to help you out. And then, you know, maybe it's a follow-up with that. Hey, we're offering a 10% discount or a free XYZ size print or whatever. But, you know, then you can, once you've established the connection in a non-salesy way,
right,
then you can very tactfully start promoting your sales messages. I mean, and you, but you need that call to action. I mean, you can't do it so subtly and so soft sell that the whole right. point of the email is missed. I mean, you need right. that call to action. You need that, you know, act now to book your session type of thing at the end of the email. You need that call to action.
Right, right. All right, Trev, listen, don't go any further with this. I know we want to go into it a little bit deeper, but before we get into this any deeper in regards to the email and email marketing, let's go ahead and take a quick break to hear from our sponsor.
Are you frustrated with slightly out of focus images when you know your autofocus spot was dead on? It's simply not your fault. From manufacturer to manufacturer, and even lens copy to lens copy, there are slight variances to the exact spot where light is being focused onto the sensor. Finally, there's a product that allows you to compensate for those variances and make sharper images immediately. Focus Pyramid, the autofocus lens calibration tool, is an absolute must for every photographer. If you want to make the sharpest images possible, then you need to take control over your camera's focusing system. With the Focus Pyramid, you can calibrate all of your lenses on your lunch break. The Focus Pyramid makes lens calibration quick and easy at an affordable price. So give your lenses a new lease on life and take your photography to the next level. Head over to focuspyramid.com/DPC and get an additional 10% off just for being a show listener.
So, all right, Trev, we are back here. And, you know, we were talking about marketing to past clients. Let's go ahead and get into it a little bit about marketing to possible future clients.
Yeah, sure. You know, they always say that approaching and contacting previous clients is always an easier sell.
Absolutely.
Than trying to sell to somebody who doesn't even know you, to a brand new client. Right. So, you know, you really need to continue to build business. You have to be seeking out new prospects. This is a vital part of doing business. If you only try and sell to existing clients over and over again, eventually, you know, that well is going to dry up. You know, yeah. Eventually they're not going to need your services at that point in time. And, you know, all your eggs in one basket type of thing. And then before you know it, you're out of business, you're out of work, you got nothing to do, and you're, on the unemployment line. You know?
People are only, you know, only so many people are going to find you via organic Google, Google search, no matter, you know, how much you pay the guy for SEO, he's going to get to the top. You know, this is only going to do so much, right?
Well, that's right. That's right. And you want to bring them into the fold, let's say, early on in the process, before they actually even realize that they need a photographer or know exactly. that they want a photographer. Because yes, the fact of the matter is, we talked last week even, photography is one of those types of services that people don't need every day of their lives.
Nope.
And when they do finally need it, they're going to go to either someone they've used in the past, someone that has been recommended to them, or right. they're going to pick up the phone book or go to Google and do a search for a local photographer. And then just right. start browsing through the website.
And that's the last of the list right there.
It number is the one, last of the list.
First absolutely. And foremost is what comes through their email box and what their friends say on Facebook. I think that's right. That right now, as of 2012, that's what it is. They're on Facebook and they're like, hey, you know, you just had a wedding. Who did you use?
Right.
And then there's this, you know, silence for a few seconds. And then the person's back like within seconds. Oh, I use so-and-so. Go look at our pictures. And they'll cut and paste the URL and boom, all of a sudden the potential client is now looking at, you know, someone that you just did wedding photos online. I mean, you're not going to get any better than that, right?
No, that's right. That's right. And you know, what you need to do is you need to get these prospects on your email list. It's the best, most economical way to continually keep in touch with people to eventually get them on as a customer, as opposed to trying to do cold calling and stuff. So, you know, like for example, they do, if you're a wedding photographer, you do a wedding show. You know, one of the things right. that you always want to try and get when you're at a show is a name and email. Well, they're, right. you know, people just aren't going to voluntarily give it to you out of the kindness of their heart because they know what's coming. They know that it's going to be an email marketing thing. So right. you need to give them something in return that has a high perceived value, something exactly. that they're really going to be willing to exchange that equity, you know, to give you their email address in exchange for whatever it is you're offering. So,
right. It doesn't need to be like, you know, like an iPad, like we just gave away last week for $500. It could be something small. But I would say something specific. So if you're at a bridal show, maybe you give away, you know, a session, right?
Right.
With a bride. Let's say maybe it's a boudoir, a bridal boudoir session, or, you know, maybe it's an engagement session. And you actually give that away with the hopes that after you do that, you actually get the wedding itself because they just love the picture so much. You know, the hardest thing is to get on people's radar. If you are a good photographer, your work is going to sell itself. I mean, you know, so many times I'm like, well, how am I going to get in front of these people? Because I know as soon as, you know, I show them the work, I'm going to sell them. But how do you get there? And that's a great way, getting in front of them, getting into their inbox.
Yeah, no, that's absolutely right. I mean, contests and giveaways work great. And yes, if you're at a show like that and you have that face-to-face connection with people, and you can get them into some form of a giveaway like that. I really like that idea. I think a bridal boudoir is an awesome idea. You know, it's a great way to get it. And think about it. You know, like we just gave away an iPad. So those iPads are $500.
Right.
You know, you don't have to spend $500 of your own money to give away an iPad. But in exchange, you can give $500 worth of your time.
Exactly.
You know, and actually do this session for somebody. That really has high perceived value. Now, if you're, maybe that's not what you're doing. Maybe you're a photographer, but, you know, kind of an area that you want to move into is teaching. I know a lot of photographers like to teach locally. Well, a great way to do that is maybe you offer some form of email tips or video tips or something like that, how to shoot better.
And maybe an ebook, An ebook for them to
read. An ebook. And then you connect with them through maybe social media or something first, and you promote, hey, we're giving away a free ebook. To learn how to make better pictures and what have you. I mean, of course, you got to put your own personal spin on it, but you direct them over to your website, to an email sign-up form, you get them on the list.
And that kind of brings you into kind of like a autoresponder type of thing. So, you know, once you start, you can't, you know, you don't just drop the ball after that and say, oh, well, I contacted them. I never heard anything. No, it's like, it's got to be this continuous thing. As long as you're offering something else for free or a tidbit of some kind, you know, you can email them. You have to have an opt-out at the bottom. If not, that's why we say try MailChimp, because MailChimp is going to do it all for you. If someone doesn't want to hear from you anymore, so be it. They don't have to. They can click one button and, you know, rest assured they won't hear from you ever again. But as long as they want to hear, you need to talk to them. You need to keep that communication going. And I think that one of the best ways is through an autoresponder type of campaign, right?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, let's say you are doing photography tips. So they come in, they sign up in your form, they get added into the MailChimp list. MailChimp will, through an autoresponder, will automatically send them their first tip. And, you know, that could be a link to a video that's on your website, or it could just be a text tip, you know, just something in text. So, you know, you can have it sent out like that. And then what will happen is you can actually set up autoresponders. So the next week, another one will be sent out. And then the next week, another one will be sent out, and so on and so on. But you don't want to just offer them the tip for free with nothing else. I mean, obviously, if you're selling your teaching, then maybe you have a DVD video series that you put together or something like that. So you want to let them know in that email about your DVDs. And that can be at the bottom, underneath the meat, underneath the real content of the email. But you need to utilize that connection for your sales, because that's ultimately what your end goal is. And, you know, and maybe if they haven't purchased within the first four emails that you send out, maybe on the fifth email, there's a 10% discount coupon. You know, maybe that's the kicker they need to come in and to finally buy. So it really is a whole marketing effort that you really have to think about and put into place. It takes time. It's not going to be something you're going to bang out in a couple hours. You got to think, come up with your game plan, and then you have to actually go in and set up MailChimp to make it do what you want it to do.
Don't forget, you don't have to have this information, like we're saying, you have to give something away all the time. You know, just by getting that communication going, remember, every time there's Flag Day, there's, you know, any type of holiday, you got Christmas, Hanukkah, you have Valentine's Day, you have every single holiday is just another reason why you can say hello, how are you doing?
Yep.
And if you were smart about gathering your data to begin with, you chances are will have their anniversary dates too. Well, why not say hello on their anniversary also? So there's so many reasons for getting in touch with people, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. And you know what? Maybe for the, you know, happy anniversary type of email, maybe that email you send from your personal email box, you know, you send it right from a mail application. But for your bulk emailings that you're doing, you definitely don't want to use your personal email. That you absolutely want to use a service like MailChimp, Constant Contact, you know, iContact. I mean, there's a whole bunch of them out there. You definitely want to use something like that, because if your personal email ever gets flagged as spam, then your domain is actually going to be put in the blacklist.
Very bad.
That has catastrophic effects. Absolutely. I mean, then all of a sudden your website is no longer accessible, you know, to certain ISPs. So definitely, you know, do not do bulk emailings from your personal account. You know, definitely look into a mail service provider and take action. Make it happen, because it's a key part of your marketing.
So, you know what, Trev? Last week, we alluded to another great giveaway.
Yes,
that,
we did.
That we have coming, right?
I love giveaways, man.
Oh, my God. Yeah, last week was $500, right? Which was the iPad, the new iPad, not the HD, not the iPad 3, the new iPad. That was $500. And now, you know, next coming up in the next week, we will have the Epson Stylus Photo R2000, right? Which is really cool because this is a wide format printer. So this is a really nice one. This is another $500. Get into that just a little bit, because I know we wanted to talk to everyone about that. What's coming?
Yeah. So by the time you hear this on Monday, May 21st, this new giveaway will be starting, and it'll run until the following Monday, May 28th, just like the previous promotion did. So you'll have a full week to enter, and you can go over to the website, of course. You can get all the details there. We'll have a post up at the top, just like we did for the previous one, and you can enter right there. But yeah, this printer is really nice. It's a 13-inch wide format printer, and for cut sheet sizes, it'll do up to a 13 by 19.
That's awesome.
And then if you want to do roll media, it'll do 13 by 44. So you can do a nice big panorama with that and stuff.
Love that.
Really nice stuff. It uses the full range of Epson's media. So all their different art papers, their watercolor papers, all their stuff. I mean, it's fantastic.
And you know, Epson's ink is the best ink out there, period.
It really is. Story. Yeah, they're archival. They're the, you know, intensity of the colors. And this system uses individual ink cartridges, not, you know, like one brick that's got, you know, the CMYK in it. It uses individuals, which is perfect, because if you print something with a lot of black in it, you're going to burn through your black ink first. Well, you can just replace the black. You don't have to do the whole set.
Yeah.
And, you know, of course, they use, you know, cyan, magenta, yellow, black, you know, light cyan, light magenta. There's an orange in this one as well.
Which is
something unique. So they're really going for more of those being able to hold true to, like, let's say those fall colors with the orange leaves and stuff, rather than trying to make that orange out of magenta and yellow. It can actually use an orange ink, which will make it a lot more intense in color.
That's why a lot of these printers also have multiple blacks. So they have like a light black, a medium black, and a black, like a black, photo black.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah. So
this thing will even print on CDs and DVDs.
Nice.
Yeah. So it's got the little tray to print on those. So
I hear that it's really cool. You know what I like too? It's Wi-Fi. I love a Wi-Fi printer. I'm like spoiled with them now. You know, I always like to just print something from wherever I am. I like to be able to print from my iPad, print from my iPhone. Having a Wi-Fi connected printer is just a godsend. I love it. I just wander around the house and just hit print.
And then
I go outside in the foyer and it's sitting there, you know. It's just cool.
Well, Epson has that Wi-Fi app for your iPhone, iPad and stuff.
Exactly.
So, yeah, if you're out shooting with your iPhone, you can just go to that app and print right to your device. It's really cool. We do that here. I've got a Wi-Fi Epson here at the office. And yeah, if I'm out shooting some stuff with the iPhone, I can go in, just snap off a couple 4x6 prints. It's awesome. Love it. So anyway, go to the website, check it out on Monday. It will be live, and enter to win this really, really cool printer. So Joe, I think it's time. What do you say we get out of here?
We're out.
We are out. So thanks everybody for taking your time to listen. And of course, if you have any questions or comments like Mike did, feel free to send them in to us. We'd love to read them. You can send them through digitalphotographycafe.com. We got a contact form right there. Or just connect with us on Twitter at DPhotoCafe. So Joe, if people want to learn more about all the cool stuff you're up to, how can they connect with you?
They can find me on my website, AlloreMM.com, on Twitter, that's at Joseph Christina, and that's Christina without an H, on Facebook, facebook.com/AlloreMM, and finally on Google Plus, you can go over to gplusjc.com.
Cool, and you can keep up with me on Twitter, it's at Trevor Current, and get even more photography goodness from our other Twitter account at Current Photo. And of course, check out our website, currentphotographer.com, and facebook.com/currentphotographer.
So, all right, Trevor, we are done. Another great show, as always. I'd like to thank the listeners there for their continued support. If you enjoy the show, we encourage you to subscribe for free in iTunes or via RSS and have them all delivered directly to your computer for free. Can't beat free, right?
Yes.
Listen, if you're listening on the go, fear not. Everything that we covered during this week's show can easily be found in our show notes at our website, digitalphotographycafe.com. Once again, keep your questions and comments coming, and we'll talk to you next week. And that's a wrap.